Hey, welcome back, guys. So back behind me back there is my new computer. It's a mid-2012 15-inch non-Retina MacBook Pro, and we're going to put it through its paces and see if it can hold its own in 2018 and beyond. So here we go. All right, so like I said, this is a mid-2012 MacBook Pro. It's got a 2.6 gigahertz quad-core i7-3720QM processor. When I got the machine, it had 8 gigs of 1600 megahertz DDR3 RAM. It came with a 500 gigabyte 5200 RPM drive, which was absolutely painful. And that's one of the first things I swapped out on this machine. So this model has two graphics cards. It's got the integrated HD 4000 graphics, and it's got 1.5 gigabytes for that. But it also has a discrete NVIDIA GT650M with a dedicated 1 gigabyte of RAM for that. And it's running High Sierra. So like I said, when I got this machine, it just had the 500 gigabyte 5200 RPM drive. I can't say that without laughing because that thing is so slow these days. And it had 8 gigabytes of RAM. So the first thing I did was I swapped out that hard drive and I put in a 500 gigabyte SSD drive. And then I also bumped the 8 gigs of RAM up to 16 gigs of 1600 DDR3 RAM. Opening these things up and swapping the RAM and the hard drives and stuff is so easy. And I really, of all the things Apple's done, I really wish they still did this. You just unscrew some screws on the bottom, pop the bottom plate off, and you have access to basically anything that you'll need to swap out. You can even swap out the battery. It's not super easy, but it is doable. So looking at the machine, along the left side is the MagSafe charging port. This is another thing I wish they still had. Gigabit Ethernet port, FireWire 800 port, a Thunderbolt / mini display port. So it's a Thunderbolt port. You can also just plug a standard mini display cable in there. It has two USB 3.0 ports, and that's an important difference between the 2012 model and the 2011 model. 2011 only had USB 2. 2012 is when they first started doing the USB 3.0. It's also got an SD card reader and audio line in and out. Along the right side, there's no ports. You just have the laptop lock and the super drive or DVD drive. So the screen on this thing is actually really, really nice. Even by today's standards, it's really clear. It's very bright. The viewing angles are great. It's not the Retina display, so the resolution on it is really low. It's 1440 by 900, which sounds ridiculously low. But it's weird because I don't know if it's the way the operating system's designed. I've never had an issue with that resolution. I thought it would drive me crazy. I've used laptops with, you know, 1366 by whatever it is resolution, and it just drives me crazy. I can't even use them. But for some reason on this MacBook, the resolution has not been an issue for me. All right, so let's get into the performance a little bit. And I was actually super, super surprised on this. On day-to-day activities, web browsing, you know, using your word processors, all that stuff, it works flawlessly, and I'm not surprised about that. Even a 5-year-old Windows machine will work just fine with that. Where I was really blown away is the editing. So I was able to edit 4K video on this, you know, 6-year-old machine with virtually no problem. Final Cut Pro definitely works the best. It's smooth scrubbing. Everything was just completely smooth. The only thing is I had to have a little delay when you add a transition. You have to wait for it to render, but it's only just, you know, 2 or 3 seconds. The scrubbing of the 4K was just totally smooth. I didn't have to use any proxies or anything. In Adobe Premiere, it was not quite as smooth, but I was still able to scrub through the video, do my cuts, play it back, not a problem at all, worked just great. And DaVinci Resolve as well, worked just fine. I didn't have to use transcoding in any of those pieces of software. Premiere and DaVinci Resolve were a little choppier than Final Cut Pro was. Final Cut Pro was just buttery smooth, and those are with the videos right off my Lumix G7 camera. So I was completely, completely blown away with that. Much better than I ever thought it would be on, you know, a 6-year-old laptop. All right, so we got to talk about gaming, right? So I'm only going to talk about Mac OS gaming. You can do, boot camp and load Windows onto this machine, and you're going to get better performance in Windows with the gaming than you are in the Mac OS. I was not going to go through it because this is a 5-year-old machine. It's got a 650M video card in there. So it's not, I didn't buy it for a gaming machine. So I'm only going to talk about the macOS gaming. So we got to talk about Minecraft first, because if I don't, I'm going to get all kinds of questions. Minecraft runs just fine. No problem. You know, that's, again, to be expected. The 650M video card is plenty enough for Minecraft. And then some Steam games I tried as well. There's one that I really like. It's called Oxygen Not Included. That works totally fine. No stuttering, anything like that. So lower graphics games like that work great. If you're talking about, you know, first-person shooters, you know, a little more graphically intensive games, you're going to be able to play them. Like I played 7 Days to Die. I had to set everything super, super low. And then I was able to get above 30 frames per second and make it playable. Looked like crap, but it was playable. So again, this isn't a gaming machine. And if you really do want a game on it, load Windows in Boot Camp, switch over to Windows. You're going to get better performance. Now, in addition to just playing the games on the device itself, you can also stream. Now, there's a couple ways you can stream. You can use the Steam in-home streaming, and with the solid Wi-Fi on this, and especially if you use the gigabit connection, it works great. My gaming machine is a Windows machine. This is a Mac laptop, but it doesn't matter because it's just streaming. It doesn't care what the server and the client is. Everything worked great over my home network. You know, there's very little latency with Steam in-home streaming, and everything just worked fine. Now, the next thing I want to talk about is the NVIDIA GeForce Now. GeForce Now, and this is free right now, so if you're watching this, go check it out, because pretty soon they're going to start paying for it. But GeForce Now is a game streaming service. So basically what you do is you create an account, you log in, and then you can link that GeForce Now service to your Steam account, and then you can have access to all the Steam games that you've purchased. And there's even some non-Steam games in there, like Fortnite is in there. That's not available on Steam. So what happens is these games play and process on the NVIDIA servers with their monster video cards, their monster specs, and all the video is streamed to you, and your clicks and keyboard presses are streamed back. It's really low latency, and for most games, it's totally fine. You're not going to want to do any competition on this, and things like I tried Fortnite, and I also tried PUBG, and in addition to just sucking at these games, there was a little bit of latency that caused me to miss some shots. Nothing horrible, definitely still playable, but you can just notice a slight difference versus playing it like through the Steam in-home streaming. But it's fantastic what they can do. The only thing about the service is you need a monster internet connection, and it has to be fast and stable. But if you have that, it works great. All right, so there you go, guys. A 2012 MacBook Pro. Who would have thought in 2018 it would still be a viable option? Does 4K video editing, plays a few games, and day-to-day activity, it just kicks butt. That screen is really nice. You can output to a monitor and get 1440p, which honestly, I have a 4K monitor, and I always set my resolution to 1440 anyway, because otherwise everything just gets too small. So for me, this was absolute sweet spot, the 2012 year. 2011, you only have USB 2.0, you only have the HD 3000 graphics, and then you have the slower dedicated graphics cards if you get the model with that. In 2013, you start using some of those user accessible parts, you lose access to that. And then, you know, 2013 and then on beyond, you start losing ports and stuff too. So 2012 is that sweet spot. If you're looking for a Mac, you may want to consider checking out one of these. Again, I got it for $500. And then the upgrades I put in, I had on hand, but those upgrades wouldn't be that expensive anyway if you bought them outright. And I'm actually really happy with this purchase. And I definitely recommend it if you're looking to get your feet wet in the Mac OS, which is a fantastic operating system. So thanks so much for watching, guys. I appreciate you stopping by again. Please come see me on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. If you haven't subscribed yet, please consider subscribing, and I will see you next time.